Coelacanths are an ancient lineage of fish and are possibly the most famous rediscovery of a species assumed to be extinct. They are more known for their rediscovery than for anything else, but they are still a fascinating group with many unique adaptations. As usual, a document with the sources for the images used, along with research papers I found useful, will be included in the description of this video. I always find it a little awkward to talk about something commonly called a fish. And this is because phylogenetically, there is either no such thing as a fish, or all vertebrates must be fish. To explore the reason for this, let's start with a quick phylogeny of living vertebrates. The most basal living vertebrates are the lampreys and hagfish. These make up the infraclass Agnatha, or the jawless fish. As this name suggests, they are primitive lineages as they lack a true jaw. The next living lineage is Chondrichthyes, or the cartilaginous fish. This contains the sharks, rays, and chimeras. They are notable for having skeletons composed mostly of cartilage instead of having bones like the later lineages. The remaining living vertebrates are divided into two clades. The first is Actinopterygii, or the ray-finned fish. This contains about half of all living vertebrates. The largest infraclass in it by far is Teleosteae, which contains 26,000 species, or about 96% of all living fish. There are a few other lineages within this clade, however, with closely related groups that are not considered true teleosts, such as the reedfish or sturgeons. The other clade is Sarcopterygii, or the lobe-finned fish. This clade contains the subject of today's video, the coelacanths. They are the most basal living class of this clade, but we will return to them soon. The coelacanths had their DNA genome sequenced in 2013, as it was believed that they might be the closest living ancestor to the tetrapods. However, this analysis disproved that theory, indicating that the closest relatives were actually dipnoi, or the lungfish. There are only 6 species of these still around today, but as the name suggests, they have lungs, and so are able to breathe in the air. Actually, only one species can get all of its oxygen needs from its gills. The others all require at least some oxygen from air. Finally, we come to Tetrapoda. This is the clade that includes all the other groups of vertebrates, amphibians, reptiles, birds, and mammals. Now, I hope you can see why the term fish should either include everything or should not be used at all when looking at vertebrates from a phylogenetic standpoint. If you want to call the Actinopterygii fish, that would be fine if that was all we were calling fish, as they are a self-contained clade. However, if you want to call sharks, or lampreys, or coelacanths, or all three, fish, then all of their common descendants must also be fish, which would include rats, owls, crocodiles, and all other tetrapods. This is because the tetrapods are more closely related to coelacanths and lungfish than those so-called fish are to any of the ray-finned fish. Okay. With the tangent about the common usage of fish over, let us focus in on the coelacanths. During the tangent, I did cover their placement compared to other vertebrates, so they are more closely related to lungfish and tetrapods than they are to any of the other types of fish. Coelacanths are in the class Actinistia, which only has a single order, the coelacanthiforms. They are an ancient group, with the oldest known species dating back 410 million years to the early Devonian period. The Devonian is sometimes known as the Age of Fish, as it is when jawed fish reached their peak diversity, and the coelacanths were part of this explosion in biodiversity. They are believed to have diverged from the lungfish and tetrapods slightly earlier than this, however, in the Silurian period. The coelacanths are probably the best example of why the Sarcopterygians are named the lobe-finned fish. Coelacanths have 8 fins, each having robust bones and muscles, more similar to tetrapods like humans than they are to any of the ray-finned fish. The coelacanths actually have a very extensive fossil record, with over 100 different fossilized species known. While the only coelacanths alive today are marine deepwater fish, prehistoric coelacanths lived in a variety of different habitats, from marine to brackish to freshwater. Despite their early origins, they were never as diverse as most other groups of fish, but reached their peak diversity during the early Triassic period. The Devonian coelacanths were small, being about 30 to 40 centimetres or 12 to 16 inches long. The most primitive of these is Megrashia, which despite its age is actually a species we know a bit about, as fossils of it in various life stages have been discovered. It lived in estuaries, where it was likely the main predator. The juveniles appeared similar to the adults, but their caudal fins were notably longer. Coelacanths, in general, typically follow similar body plans, so despite the number of species, there are not any that seem particularly odd. Some, like Holopterygius, did deviate superficially from most coelacanths, however. Holopterygius had an elongated body that made it look more eel-like. This is very much the exception and not the rule. It is unknown why they had such a drastically different body plan than that of most other coelacanths, but it was presumably due to their lifestyle and ecology. Diplocercides was a genus of marine coelacanths with three known species found in modern-day Poland and Germany. They are worth mentioning, however, as they are one of the few extinct coelacanths to have their brain cavity preserved three-dimensionally. This important find has helped shape our understanding of not only coelacanth evolution, but also of their relationship to other Sarcopterygians. Coelacanths are not only known from the Devonian period, however. Elenipterus was from the Carboniferous about 318 million years ago. It was discovered in a fossil formation in Montana in the United States. It had an oddly humped appearance with a tapering tail and was likely a close relative of Holopterygius given its similar body plan. It stayed small, only getting to around 15 centimeters or 6 inches long. While they were relatively small in the Devonian and Carboniferous, coelacanths became much larger during the Mesozoic era. The largest found so far is Morsonia, a coelacanth that could get up to a massive 5.3 meters or 17.4 feet long. It lived in freshwater and estuaries during the late Jurassic to late Cretaceous period. Its diet is unknown, but there are several theories on what it might have eaten. Some people suggest it might have swallowed prey whole by suction feeding, while others say it could have crushed hard-shelled organisms, but there is no concrete evidence for either theory. Part of the reason for this uncertainty is that it did not have teeth, but instead its mouth had small denticles. A denticle is a tooth-like projection, but these were tiny given the size of Morsonia, only being about 1 to 2 millimeters wide. Another Mesozoic giant was Trachymetapon, found in Europe during the Jurassic period. The largest found was estimated to be 5 meters or 16 feet long, but it is only known from one of the bones in its skull, so this size could be questionable. If you have heard of coelacanths before, then it is likely that you have heard the story of their rediscovery. Coelacanth fossils were found during the dinosaur craze in the 1800s. At this time, Western scientists were unaware that any of them still survived. It was assumed that the coelacanths were another casualty of the extinction event at the end of the Cretaceous period, around 66 million years ago. This was the extinction event most famous for wiping out the non-avian dinosaurs, but its impacts were much greater than just that, as it caused the extinction of an estimated 75% of all species. It would not be until over a century after coelacanth fossils were first found that a living coelacanth was discovered. Well, living is not entirely accurate, as it was dead, but recently so. Marjorie Courtney Latimer was the curator of the East London Museum in South Africa. She was known to fishermen, as she would often be interested in feathers, shells and the like for her museum. On the 22nd of December 1938, one of these fishermen would call her to tell her of an unusual fish he had caught. She immediately went to have a look and would later describe it as mauve blue, with whitish flecks and iridescent. It was about 5 feet long and had four limb-like fins. It was like no fish she had ever seen. She rang the nearest ichthyologist, James Smith at Rhodes University, but received no reply. She would then telegram him some sketches, but Smith was on holiday, so would not see her messages for some time. In the meantime, the museum was not interested in the specimen, with the chairman telling Courtney Latimer that it was nothing but a rock cod. There were only two refrigeration units in the town large enough to store the fish, including the morgue, and neither of these facilities would agree to help. So, with no reply from Smith, Courtney Latimer was forced to get the specimen taxidermied to prevent it from rotting. James Smith returned from holiday and saw the sketches on the 3rd of January. He immediately recognized it as a coelacanth. When describing it to science, he would place it in the genus Latimeria in honor of Courtney Latimer. The second species of coelacanth to be discovered would actually be found in a very similar way, although much more recently. On the 18th of September 1997, Mark Erdman was travelling in the island of Sulawesi, Indonesia, on his honeymoon. He would stop at a local fish market when he saw an unusual-looking fish. At first, he thought it was the West Indian Ocean coelacanth, But it was a different colour. Instead of the bluish tinge the other species is known for, this specimen was brown. Erdemann took a few photographs before the fish was sold. He would return a few months later to interview fishermen and try to find another specimen. In 1998, a fisherman caught another specimen and delivered it still alive to Erdemann. The fish survived for around 6 hours, during which time Erdemann photographed its coloration, fin movements, and behavior. He published his findings in Nature in 1998. In 1999, Poyaud et al. Published their own findings on the Indonesian coelacanth and assigned it a scientific name without consulting Erdemann. When Erdemann complained about this, they claimed to have been doing their own research on the species since 1995, thus predating Erdemann's find. However, upon closer inspection, the photographic evidence they gave were forgeries, so the credit for the discovery is given to Erdemann. The first species discovered was the West Indian Ocean coelacanth, Latimeria chalumnae. Despite its first discovery by Western science in South Africa, it is most common around the Comoros Islands, Mozambique, and Madagascar. It was known to fishermen earlier than this, especially in the Comoros Islands, where it was locally known as gombesa. It is a very distinctive fish, with its 8 limb-like fins, striking blue coloration and paler white spots. This speckled appearance helps with camouflage when hunting prey. They are typically around 80 kilograms or 176 pounds heavy, and can get up to 2 meters or 6.5 feet long. Coelacanths are nocturnal. They spend their day in caves, only leaving at night to feed in the surrounding waters. They are typically found at depths of 180 to 210 meters, or 590 to 690 feet. But this is believed to be the preference, as this is where the underwater caves they favour are most common, and they have been found both higher and lower in the water column. They are generalist predators targeting many different species of fish. They do have a unique behaviour, where they perform an underwater headstand. This is used to capture prey from the sea floor, or from crevices within the caves. This is thought to only be possible because the coelacanth is the only known vertebrate with a bony skeleton capable of moving both its upper and lower jaws. The handstand position is believed to be an energy-saving behavior, which is important given their slow metabolism. Coelacanths have good eyesight. Given its nocturnal and cave-dwelling lifestyle, it is not particularly surprising, but their eyes have additional rods to improve their vision in low-light conditions. Unique to them is the presence of a vestigial lung filled with fat. This is thought to have a similar function to the swim bladder seen in other fish, controlling their buoyancy for living in deep water. The presence of this lung may also explain the unusual placement of the kidneys in coelacanths. The two kidneys have been fused into one and are placed after the cloaca at the rear of the fish, a much further back placement than is seen in other living fish. Coelacanths are ovoviviparous. This means that they have eggs, but they incubate these within their bodies until they hatch, at which point the baby coelacanths will emerge from the mother. However, they have one of the longest gestation periods of any known animal, carrying around the fertilized eggs for 5 years. These eggs are large and are only protected by a thin membrane. The number of young the female will have at one time is not known for certain, but a female dissected in 1975 contained 5 embryos. But others have many more, up to 26, so the average number is difficult to know. Young coelacanths resemble the adults, but have an external yolk sac to provide them with nutrients until they are large enough to hunt. Coelacanths do not reach sexual maturity until they are 40 to 60 years old, and may live until they are around 100. This means that they have one of the slowest growth histories of any marine fish. It also means that any pressure put on their populations, whether fishing from humans or a disaster or disease that kills a large amount of them, will put severe pressure on the remaining individuals and make it difficult for their population to recover. Coelacanths are unpalatable to humans, and presumably most other fish-eating animals. This is because their meat contains large amounts of oil, urea, wax esters, and other compounds, giving them a distasteful flavour. The scales also secrete a mucus, making them rather slimy. They are difficult to digest, so if a person does eat one, they generally experience diarrhea and other side effects, although it is not fatal. Fishermen often catch coelacanths when fishing for oilfish, as the oilfish is active at night in similar habitats to coelacanths. Before it became known as a species of interest to scientists, the fishermen would throw the coelacanths back into the water as they have little to no commercial value. Once their scientific value was recognized, fishermen would start trading them to scientists and officials instead of returning them to the ocean. Unfortunately, this puts further pressure on the remaining coelacanth populations, and they are marked as critically endangered by the IUCN. This assessment does need updating, however, as it was last assessed in 2000, and very little of its habitat and population was known at that time. To be honest, the IUCN Red List website is a source I tend to rely on quite a bit to write many of these videos, especially when I'm talking about a threatened species. However, I have never seen a critically endangered animal with as little information as the West Indian Ocean coelacanth has. They have not even provided a justification as to why it is listed as critically endangered. Other sources do suggest the remaining population may contain as few as 500 individuals, which, if true, is a serious concern, especially given their slow growth and reproduction rates. The other species of coelacanth alive today is the Indonesian coelacanth, Latimeria menadoensis. They are not as well known or well studied as the West Indian Ocean coelacanths, so while it is assumed that many of the features known from that species apply to both, it is not known for sure. Indonesian coelacanths are found in the waters north of Sulawesi and also around Papua and West Papua. The notable difference from the West Indian Ocean coelacanths, as I mentioned when recounting the story of its rediscovery, is its coloration. They still have the pale flecks throughout its body, although in the Indonesian coelacanth, these are not only white but also gold. However, the base color is brownish gray, unlike the striking blue of the other species. Indonesian coelacanths do not get quite as large, only being 31 to 51 kilograms, or 68 to 112 pounds heavy, and 1.4 meters or 4.6 feet long. The Indonesian coelacanth is assumed to be ovoviviparous, like its more well-known cousin, but no females containing eggs or embryos have ever been found, so this is speculation. It is rated as vulnerable by the IUCN, so is believed to be much more common than the West Indian Ocean coelacanth. Despite this, not many have been captured, so little is really known about it. It is assumed that its population has fewer than 10,000 individuals, and its presumed low birth rate and long lifespan means that it will struggle to recover if it becomes overexploited. Its main threat is becoming bycatch, however. As mentioned earlier, coelacanths are not desirable for being directly targeted by fisheries, but this does not stop them from being caught when those fisheries are targeting other species. Before finishing, there is one newer discovery about the living coelacanths that I want to cover. This is the potential that there is a third species. The Indonesian coelacanths in the waters around West Papua might be a genetically distinct species, although this needs more research before it can be confirmed. This is a relatively recent discovery, with the study being published in 2020. West Papua is separated from Sulawesi and therefore the rest of the Indonesian coelacanth population by a deep trench and powerful ocean currents. This would act as a geographical barrier, preventing the two Indonesian coelacanth populations from interacting and breeding with each other. Genetic analysis suggests that these populations have been separated by around 13 million years and are genetically distinct. This new species has been dubbed the Papuan coelacanth, but the researchers are cautious in listing it as a separate species. The main reason for this caution is that the genetic analysis was performed on a coelacanth caught in 2018 that was largely eaten. There were not enough remains left for a morphological examination, so genetic analysis was the only tool they had available. Given that this was a single individual, and much of the fish was missing, they would like to find more coelacanths from West Papua for further study. However, the findings so far do suggest that this may be a third species previously unknown to science. For now, however, the Papuan population of coelacanths are still officially considered Indonesian coelacanths. I hope you enjoyed this video. Coelacanths are fascinating animals, once believed extinct for millions of years, but are now known to subsist in small areas of the deep oceans. They have many adaptations not seen in any other animals alive today, but are now under threat due to their slow reproduction and growth rates, their interest to the scientific community, and as bycatch for fishermen hunting other species. Thank you for listening, and feel free to suggest another group of animals you want to see me cover in the comments.